over for the children's church today because we have a special guest with us this morning, Miss Katie Posey. She is the new manager out at Faith Christian Camp, and we're awfully glad to have her with us today. She's going to be giving us a presentation on the camp and the theme for this year, and I look forward to that. Looks like Mackenzie is the prop toter as well, so if you guys want to come on up, I won't talk so you don't have to hold that anymore. Just help me make welcome Katie Posey and Mackenzie.
First row. I kind of stopped there for a while, and then I started back last year, and I kind of regret that I didn't go to every week that I possibly could, which I am going back this year, so I'm pretty happy about that, getting another second chance at it. I went 2 weeks last year, one as a counselor and one as a camper, and I'm telling you, it drew me close to God. It was awesome. I absolutely loved it. Actually drew me so close to God, in high school week, I rededicated my life. One thing that I really like about camp is your separation. Because it feels like you're separated from the world and you're out there on your own little island. It's incredible. I love it. And I would recommend it to anybody. Especially my favorite thing is campfires, but I also get really competitive during sports. So if you're coming to high school sports week, you're not going to beat me at anything.
Stories like this, and even if it wasn't Faith Christian, you may have attended a church camp that's had some kind of impact on your life. But I want you to think about now is think about your character and think about your Christian walk and what changed that. Hopefully it looks a lot better as you've changed. But I want you to think about, when you think of change, I want you to think of growth. Change isn't necessarily bad. You can go from looking like Jared's baby to what he is now. But that was a growth that took place. The camp faces a lot of different changes all the time. This year we've added a camp store, so you'll be able to look forward to that this summer. And we're hopefully adding a dock here soon that's covered, and we can put paddle boats under and take care of what we've got. There's just a lot of different things that are going to start taking place as you walk around the campus. You'll see that it's improvements. And if you're like me, when I was younger, when I got there and realized they had the AC in the cabins, I was furious. Now I'm very thankful for that change, and I've learned to appreciate the air conditioning that's given to me. So just something to think about. When you see the camp and you see the changes, think of it more as a growth. My dad, you know, he grew because of what happened to him at camp, and because of what happened to him there, it was a chain reaction, and he found it beneficial, and he sent me to camp, and that's what has changed me and caused me to grow. And I know that some of you are thinking, can I go back to camp, or who can I send to camp? It starts with you all. It doesn't have to be, hey, I want to go to camp, but I'm too old. You have the chance to make an impact. You can send a kid to camp. You can get involved. Jared just told you that by counseling, he had probably one of the best experiences of his life, just going back and helping and getting involved out there. So after the service, if you want to get involved and you think that's something that God's calling you to do, come see me, come talk to me. Mackenzie's like my right-hand woman. She probably answers more questions than I do. So if you'd rather talk to her, that's fine too. But take a look at Mark 16:15, and like I said, Rob's going to get up here and talk about it here in a second. And think about what you can do and how you can get involved in a kid's life, cause them to change, and maybe that kid can go and change the world and make this world a better place. You know, it's disheartening to see what's going on in the world, but I have to look at it as, you know, this is a growth. We're taking a growth toward Christ and growing closer to Him. I think that's it. Okay, partner. I'm going to leave you with a video. It kind of gives you a little bit of picture of what the camp's been through and how it's changing and how it's good and how it's for the better growth. So thank you. I appreciate it. If you want to talk to me afterward, I'll be out back.
I pray that
How many here have been to Faith Christian Camp at least one time?
More than once.
Just once, all that qualified. Leave them up. Now, everybody else, just look around and see how many people have went as a camper. I went as a kid, and I went back as a cabin dad, and I've worked there many hours with Brother Elmer. And the camp is an important ministry for our churches. Not only like Jared and Hannah shared with you, and Katie as well, is it to where you can go or you can send your child and they learn about Christ or are drawn closer to Christ. But something that I can remember, and the kids may relate to this more so, but for the kids that maybe don't know each other when they get there, we still send them to school together. And they get up to the high school or the middle school, and they see a familiar face. Where did I see that person? I met a person at church camp when I went, and he and I played basketball together in middle school, and it took us till we started off in eighth grade, and it took us till we was freshmen to figure out where we met at. But we had met at church camp, and we had that bond from both places. So they make friends, and not only do they make friends, they have the opportunity to influence other kids. And that's what we really, as Christians, are called to do, isn't it? I mean, we're called salt so that we might flavor, and we're called light so we might bring people out of darkness. That's to influence those that we come in contact with. Well, then that's one of the great things about the camp, is that we send our kids there, and they are influenced by the counselors and the other kids that are at the camp week, and then they also have the opportunity to influence someone else. The camp theme is Go and Change the World, and that's based off of Mark 16:15. If you went ahead and looked in your Bibles, go ye into all the world, Jesus says in the first part of the scripture. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, and that he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. This is very important for us. It's a great theme, because that's what we're encouraging our kids to do, is go out and influence the world. But what about ourselves? Ask yourself this morning, how well am I doing with the go ye part? How well am I going out and influencing the world? Preaching the gospel in either the way I live or the things that I say. Now in Matthew chapter 28 and Luke verse 24 also contains this same portion of scripture. They're worded a little different, say a little different things, but it's addressing the same thing, the Great Commission, where Christ is leaving the disciples and telling them. And as I looked at these three, I thought, well, to really understand it, and to understand it properly, you really need to read all three together. But, you know, that's kind of hard to do with all of them in the back of each section. It's hard to. So what I did is I put them together, which kind of gives us the whole story so that we can really see that Jesus is teaching us a lot with this last command that he gives us, the last command that he gives the disciples. So here's how it would read if you combine them. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. Thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. And in these scriptures, Jesus gives us, whether we realize it or not, and it's hard to see it when you read it separately, but when you put it together, he gives us the plan of salvation. He gives us what we need to be preaching throughout this going into the world and teaching. And let's look at it, and he gives us some specifics. First, he says, go. Go. And that means that we have to be out among the people. We have to be out preaching the gospel of Christ in the way that either we live, that people see it, it's evident in our lives, and by the words that we speak. Remember, I was telling you, and Katie mentioned it when she said, everybody that has been to camp has a camp story. Well, you've heard me say over the past few months that we have a story as well about Jesus, don't we? We have a story to tell. And that's what Jesus is saying, is to go out and tell your story about how Christ has affected your life. Teach. Teaching sound doctrine, he says. The doctrine of the disciples, which is ultimately the doctrine that Jesus taught the disciples, which is the doctrine that we teach here, and the doctrine that is taught at the church camp as well. And witness, he says, that we're witnesses of these things. The disciples, rest assured, told their stories about how Jesus affected their lives. That's all they had, was to tell about Jesus, to tell about their relationship with Jesus, to tell about their experiences with Jesus. And it was effective. Rest assured, your story will be effective. It will never be, however, effective unless it's told. And that's the difference. Now, as I told you, if you look at this, Jesus gives us what we should be teaching or preaching, the plan of salvation, and he lays it out. Look, Jesus says, teaching about Jesus, hearing the good news, the gospel, and that's the first thing we say. We have to hear the gospel. And then what is the next thing, the next step? Jesus says that when people are taught, that people believe. Twice he says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. So after hearing the gospel, people believe the gospel. Okay? And then Jesus goes on to say, if you believe, then they confess Christ as the risen Savior. And that's what he says. That Christ, it behooves Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day. And that's what we preach, isn't it? Christ is a risen Savior, 3 days in the tomb. And then afterwards, what happens? After you hear, believe, and confess, Jesus addresses it and says, repentance, doesn't it? There has to be repentance of sin, and then once you have repentance, what else is required? Remission, or the forgiveness of sins. Now, we know how we repent of our sins. We say that. I repent. How is remission of sins granted? Jesus addresses it. Through baptism. Through baptism. That's what the scriptures say. So, after you confess, hear, believe, confess, you repent, you have the desire to have your sins forgiven, and this is done through baptism, and then what does he encourage us to do? To go out and to live faithful, to be witnesses of these things, so that we might influence others. That same story plays out at camp every year. Every year, people hear the gospel, they believe the gospel, they repent of their sins, they confess Christ as their Savior. They're buried in the likeness of his death in baptism for the remission or forgiveness of sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit, and they leave there as witnesses. Yes, camp is very important. Camp is where young Christians are made and older Christians are affirmed or encouraged. So I want to encourage you, moms and dads, aunts, uncles, grandmas, grandpas, whoever you are that has the opportunity to encourage and influence your child, grandchild, whatever the relationship, neighbor child. They don't even have to be related to you. Introduce that child to camp if they don't go to camp. And if they do, encourage them to continue to go to camp. Now, I would not condone forcing a child to go to camp because they would resent that. But if we encourage our children, or if they show interest in going to camp, for heaven's sake, do not put the fire out. Let them go. It's a great place. They have great facilities. They serve good food. The children are safe there. There's adult supervision. They have made all of the necessary accommodations to protect our most precious resource, which is our child. They're going to care for them. They're going to feed them. They're going to make sure they get a bath most of the time when they need one. They're going to make sure they get up and they go to bed. And if there's bad weather, we've got a building there where they can be gathered in together and kept safe in the basement. Plans are in place. They're going to be amongst kids their age. They're going to be amongst people who really, genuinely care about their well-being. Send your kids to camp. It will change their life. I guarantee it. And it'll change it for the better. Now, let's talk about this go ye. Jesus said, go ye. While he was going, wasn't it? And where was Jesus going? We recall? He was going to prepare a place for us, wasn't he? And if he was going to prepare a place, what did he say? I'm coming back. So if Jesus is going and doing his work in preparation of coming back, shouldn't we as Christians be going, doing our work in preparation for Jesus returning? Is that not reasonable? But you have to be on board with Christ as your Savior first. If you've never accepted Jesus as your Savior, and you have heard the gospel and you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and he was crucified, buried, and raised on the third day, and that knowledge and belief convicts you of your sin and you're willing to repent of that sin and confess him as such as your Savior, and to receive the remission or forgiveness of those sins, you're willing to be buried with him in the likeness of his death, raise that new creation in baptism, and walk faithful as a witness, telling your story, affecting people's lives. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation here. number 349, Softly and Tenderly. Maybe you're a Christian already, and maybe you've lost a little of the fire. Easy enough to do. I'm not condemning anybody for that, because it's easy enough to do. But let me encourage you, in the times that we live, in the society that we are bringing up our kids and grandkids and whatever relations, the world can ill afford lukewarm Christians. Let that fire be rekindled in your life. Let that fire be rekindled so that you might serve, so that you might go out and affect or influence those that you come in contact with for the good. To be that witness that Jesus says that we are called to be. In either case, we're going to sing softly and tenderly. That's how he calls us. He calls us with a soft, tender voice because he truly cares for us and wants us to come to him. If you have a decision to make, would you come as we stand and sing?
I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in, and then a little light from heaven filled my soul. It made my heart in love and wrote my name above, and just a little talk with Jesus made me whole. Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all about it.